Coming up today on ISCARS Full Throttle, ISCARS heads back to Hickory Motor Speedway. We'll have the preview. We'll go close up with ISCARS driver Robert Bruce, who made his first ISCARS start of the season at Florence Motor Speedway a few weeks ago. And another Tech Talk with Scott Weaver. All that and more today on ISCARS Full Throttle.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another edition of ISCARS Full Throttle. I'm Joe Moore from the Motor Racing Network.
And I'm Tiffany Ricardo. Thanks again for joining us this week for our big Hickory preview. It's finally time, Joe, to go back to Hickory, one of the most anticipated tracks on the ISCAR schedule. We first visited Hickory back on April 1st of this year. It was the first race of the season and the first place where Eric Wilson won, which he's continued to do throughout the year.
There's a lot of history at Hickory Motor Speedway. We talked about some of this last week. It's the oldest only continuously operating track in the nation, dating back to 1951 when they held their first race there. The 2006 race season marks the 56th year of competition at the .363-mile bull ring in Hickory, North Carolina. Hickory Motor Speedway is the oldest professional sporting venue in Catawba County, North Carolina, known as the birthplace of the NASCAR stars and the world's most famous short track. Hickory Motor Speedway stands alone with a long list of history and tradition.
Legendary drivers such as Junior Johnson, Ned Jarrett, and Ralph Earnhardt all became track champions at Hickory in the 1950s. Now, what is now the Nextel Cup Series visited that track first in 1953, and they ran there until 1971, Joe, when Winston began to sponsor the series and dropped all races that were under 250 miles from the schedule. Hickory remained a popular NASCAR late model sportsman series venue, however, when the series was reformed as the Budweiser Late Model Series, now known as the Busch Series, in 1982. Hickory played a prominent part of its first season, hosting six of the series' 28 races. As more tracks began hosting Busch Series races, Hickory's involvement was progressively reduced to two races a year by 1987, and then just one by 1995. In 1998, Hickory was dropped from the schedule after 17 years. Hickory still used as a venue for NASCAR's Dodge Weekly Series and its Southern Modified Series. The USAR Hooters Pro Cup also features a race at the track, and of course, ISCARS held two events here in 2006.
Hickory Motor Speedway has been reconfigured three times in its history. Back in 1955, it was a half-mile dirt track, and then in 1967, it was paved for the first time. In 1970, Hickory was shortened a second time to its present length of .363 miles. We've mentioned the track is a .363 mile oval. There's 14 degrees of banking in turns 1 and 2, 12 degrees in turns 3 and 4, 8 degree banking on the front and back straightaway. Speedway has a seating capacity of 9,000 with 3,600 additional lawn seats.
Joe, the ISCARS drivers make no secret of the fact that Hickory is one of their absolute favorite places to race at. Hickory veteran Ned Combs has great memories of the track from early on, and we're talking really early on.
My first experience was on a racetrack was here at Hickory. I drove the water truck here when I used to stand up and lean against the seat. This is one of the old faithful racetracks here. I started here back in 77. It's a tough little racetrack. It's fast for its size, but I always enjoyed it, but never had any good luck here. We won a race back years ago, but I don't think I've finished one since.
I love Hickory. I've got quite a few laps here just because of the fact that I live in Taylorsville, which is pretty close to here. So I guess the keys to getting around here is just staying down on that white line. You can't overdrive if you get in there too hard, you're going to be pushing up in the center, and if you don't get off good, that's really kills you. So as long as you can get in not too hard, roll the center good, and be able to come off real hard, you're going to be in good shape on that, on the bottom on the white line.
I've been coming up here for probably 20 years now, and I hadn't won a race here yet, but we've been awful close. Racetrack's pretty tough. It's a tight little bull ring. Pavement's not the best in the world, so you got to have good throttle control, be able to get a hold of the racetrack. The car that don't spin the wheels up off the corner is going to be the car that wins the race. The last time we was here, we proved that. Not the fastest car always wins here.
It's pretty fast. It's an old racetrack, got a lot of history. The Dash Series, since I've been involved with it, the Dash Series, I think the first time I went there was in 90 or 91 with the Dash Series, and probably have run there at least once every year since then.
I love Hickory, obviously. Hickory's always been one of my favorite racetracks. When I first started racing in what was then the NASCAR Baby Grand Series, went to Hickory and just loved the track first time I was there. And I used to go late model sportsman racing all the time with some people that were pretty good racers, and we'd go over to Hickory and it was just a great place. Loved watching L.D. Ottinger, Jack Ingram, Butch Lindley, Harry Gant, those guys, Tommy Houston. I mean, you know, I saw those guys back when they were racing with Dale Earnhardt, and Dale Earnhardt couldn't hang with them. So Hickory's got a lot of memories to me.
Hickory's very challenging. I think it's a driver's track. I think you got to get in there and just ride. And that track's always been good to us as well, and we've ran well there. And it's a tough little short track. It's going to be beating banging for 150 laps, and everybody's going to have a great show this weekend. It's going to be awesome. And I think that's a track that it challenges everybody's skills, because you have to be on top of your game every lap. It's not something you can relax, something you can just take it easy on.
Well, this is like my home track. I ran a lot of races here since I was young. And we have a lot of success here, but the hardest thing here is getting off a corner without spinning the tires. You don't have a lot of grips.
Hickory's going to be a lot of fun coming up this weekend. It's amazing how quickly the season has moved along, dating back to the first time we were there earlier this year.
Yeah, things continue to roll along, Joe. News continues to happen. As a matter of fact, let's take a look at some of the news for this week. ISCAR's president Randy Claypool has pulled the second Shenandoah race from the schedule, citing continuing conflicts with the county that the speedway is located in. If you'll remember, the first Shenandoah race had to be postponed while teams installed special mufflers to meet the county's noise restrictions. It was the understanding of ISCAR's that the installed mufflers met the necessary decibel levels, but apparently that is not the case any longer. Randy Claypool says he felt he had to make teams aware of the uncertainty of the event so that they would not incur unnecessary expenses while preparing for a race that may never happen.
Later on in today's show, we'll introduce you to driver Robert Bruce. He made his first start in the Dash Series at Florence Motor Speedway several weeks ago, but looks like somebody else will be in the 99 car at Hickory this weekend. Gary Moore will most likely make his first Dash Series start since 2003 in the number 99 car, and he's 95% certain this team will have two cars at the race. We're still unsure, as of now, exactly who will run the 99, but the other car will be driven by Kevin Williams from Washington, D.C. This will be his first start of 2006.
And congratulations go out to Allison and Jake Hobgood, who are expecting their third child, a little boy, on October 21st. Now, conveniently, that is an off week for the ISCAR series. But according to Jake's dad, Will Hobgood, both of the other little Hobgoods have arrived early. So Jake may be on pins and needles for this weekend's race at Hickory. Also, the Hobgoods have figured out what broke on their car at Florence. A bad spot weld broke on the track bar bracket, which of course caused the bar to come loose and allow the rear end to move back and forth and shear the drive shaft in half. As Will put it, something else might break this week, but it won't be the track bar bracket.
Coming up next on Full Throttle, we'll go close up with Robert Bruce and we'll recap what happened at Hickory when we were there back in April.
And right now, let's take a look at the points as we go to break. It's still a tight battle, even though Eric Wilson's won just about everything this year.
There's more to NASCAR racing than cars going in circles. Raceline takes you behind the action. Every week we go to the shops, to test sessions, and face-to-face with the biggest names in NASCAR racing. People make those cars perform, and we bring those people to you every week on Raceline with Joe Moore.
Welcome to this week's edition of Raceline.
Welcome to Central Florida's East Coast. Discover a place so special, a game so great, and a life so easy, you never felt more at home. Luxury townhomes, single family, and custom estate residences from the 400s to over $2 million. Halifax Plantation, Old Dixie Highway, Ormond Beach.
Welcome back to this week's edition of ISCARS Full Throttle. Joe Moore and Tiffany Ricardo. We told you a few moments ago about Robert Bruce possibly not running in Hickory this weekend. He was the Rookie of the Year back in 2004 in the Dash Series.
Yeah, he was. We got a chance to catch up with the Melbourne, Florida driver at Florence, and we're going to introduce him to you now on this week's Driver Profile.
I grew up a racing fan. I didn't follow it weekly by no means. Like I said, I raced New Smyrna and Enduros and then the sportsman classes. And then once I moved to Oklahoma City, that's where I really started driving a lot, you know, with the legends and the sprint cars. Well, I had 3 years in legend cars and then 3 years in, they call them micro sprints with wings on top. So I had great success in the legend division and then the micros. And then it evolved into the Dash Series cars, which I just wanted to get onto the cup tracks and experience those facilities.
Robert has high hopes for the future of his cars and says there are a lot of advantages to coming back to this series.
First of all, as far as the economics of it, it gives you a car and the capability to run speedways and short tracks, and everybody says use it as a stepping stone. Obviously, at my age, it's something just to be able to experience the big tracks and just have fun. Obviously, there's a place for the short track races, but then I'd like to see it go back to the speedways. That way you got the common mix and draw in more participants. We're in a growing stage right now, obviously, and we're just trying to get our foothold, if you want to say, so we can draw attention to make it back to the speedways. As far as short tracks, you know, South Boston's a good track, Hickory. We were at Lake Erie 2 years ago, but they're all unique in their own way. Well, the cars need to stay kind of in the sport compact era or look, if you want to say, and not evolve into a late model looking car or anything like that. Because that's what it's all about is sport compact auto racing with the V6s. You move the bodies into a different, if you want to say, riveted together or whatever. You start going outside the box, and that's not what this series' roots are from.
Now it's time for our question of the week, sent in by you. This time, Margaret Jones of Tallahassee, Florida, had a question. Wanted to know what can and cannot be done during pit stops in ISCARS Dash Series races. Well, Margaret, thanks for writing in. Here with your answer, Scott Weaver, driver of the number 2 Pontiac.
Okay, Margaret, one thing we are allowed to do, we're allowed to put gas in the cars. We can add or take tape off the nose. Any general changes we want to change, we can change springs, we can change our shocks. We cannot change tires unless they're flat or damaged. That's one of the things we can't do. We can't change gears, carburetors, anything that's mechanical that make the car go any faster, but we can change the minor things to make the car drive and handle a little better later in the race.
I think we can get in another race or two here.
Wilson, driver of the John Boy and Billy number 4, and you're watching the ISCAR series on Full Throttle.
Discover Central Florida's East Coast, a lifestyle like no other. Miles of pristine beaches. It's the Florida you may have imagined, yet never seen. Until now, endless challenging fairways, thrilling diversions, yet laid back when you want it to be. Call Plantation Realty Services at 1-866-676-0056 or visit us online at www.plantationrealtyservices.com. We have the perfect address for your dream.
From Daytona to Darlington.
Richard Petty may be setting it up for a slingshot.
From Miami to Michigan.
At the checkered flag, maybe Jared by inches.
From the pits to the turns. For over 30 years, NASCAR fans have taken us anywhere. And we have taken them everywhere. We are the voice of NASCAR. We are the Motor Racing Network.
We're back on this week's edition of ISCARS Full Throttle, headed off to Hickory Motor Speedway this weekend. The track promoter there is Sherry Clifton. And if you recall, if you remember back that far, in April we talked to Sherry about the track and how glad she was to have the Dash Series back.
And she was so excited about us coming back this week in October. Sherry tells us why she is so proud to have her track, Hickory Motor Speedway, as part of the ISCARS family of racing venues.
The Dash Series has been known forever since their start for having exciting races and top-notch personnel in their series.
Sherry says the experience of the drivers is something the fans at Hickory love to see.
They've raced in many series, many, many tracks across the country, on up through Cup, Busch, and Truck Series.
And speaking of the fans, Sherry thinks she knows why they love the ISCARS Dash Touring Series cars so much.
They're close to the size car that most of the fans drive, but they got so much horsepower, so much maneuverability, and just, they're so racy.
Now let's recap all the excitement of the April race at Hickory Motor Speedway when Eric Wilson went to victory lane for the first time in his Dash Series career.
Danny Bagwell won the first pole of the 2006 season with a lap time of 15.713 seconds. Two-time series champion Johnny Chapman sat on the outside pole with a lap time of 15.810.
As the green flag fell, Bagwell's car seemed loose from the start. Johnny Chapman moved into the lead with Justin Hobgood in that number 5 close behind. By lap 2, Justin's brother Jake Hobgood had also moved past Bagwell, who finally seemed to gain the handle on his car and maintain the fourth position.
The first caution came on lap 19 when first-year driver Philip McGlinton spun his car in the middle of turns 1 and 2. As McGlinton spun, the leaders were racing hard into turn 1. Bagwell had just started to make an outside move when McGlinton's car bounced off the wall and into the path of the pole sitter. The two cars hit hard, sending both machines to the garage.
The race restarted with Johnny Chapman still in the lead. While he and the Hobgood brothers pulled away, Shelby, North Carolina's Scott Weaver and local driver Eric Wilson started making the move toward the front. On lap 40, Chapman's car succumbed to rear-end failure, sending the race leader to the garage.
Justin Hobgood took over the lead with Scott Weaver close behind. On lap 51, Weaver passed Hobgood for the top spot, with Wilson moving into second. Mike Watson, the number 17, was also making moves to challenge for the top 5.
On lap 69, Wilson finally passed Weaver for the lead. ISCARS officials call the halfway break at lap 78, giving the teams 10 minutes to make adjustments to their cars. As the halfway caution was displayed, Weaver spun on his way back to receive the flag, putting him way back in the pack.
When the race resumed, the top 5 were Wilson, Watts, Jake Hobgood, Justin Hobgood, and Mark Howard. Coming off turn 2 on lap 104, Watts' car broke loose and he looped his machine heading down the backstretch, but was able to continue without any damage.
By this stage in the race, Weaver had overcome his earlier spin and moved back into the second position. For several laps, he challenged Wilson for the lead, but somehow Wilson was able to hold him off. When the checkered flag waved, it was Wilson for the win. Rookie Buster Bennett in second, Scott Weaver third, then Justin Hobgood and Jake Hobgood rounding out the top 5. It was Eric Wilson's first series win in 30 starts.
You know what, it's a whole lot easier up front. My spotter just kept telling me to slow it down, keep it on the bottom. And it's so easy to overdrive here. If you do, you get a push in it, and then you end up getting loose, gets right rear hot and stuff. So thankfully, Mike kept on me the whole time, and
made me keep it on the bottom, and it proved to be a good thing.
I got a great group of guys here. This is a great race car. First time it's been in a race. Brand new car, Maxi Bush. Every guy on the crew worked their tails off today. We run two classes, and we had to forget something. That would be the thing. At least we come home second. It's a good night for us.
We made our way to the front pretty quick. We took the lead, I think, about lap 50. Then I had a little driver. I spun the thing out running second there just a few laps before the halfway mark. We made some changes at halfway. Got a little bit better, but still wasn't as good as it needed to be. On the long run, I was a little bit better. The cautions at the end of the race kind of hurt me pretty bad. I don't think I could have beat Eric. I believe he was a little better across the center of the corner than I was, and congratulations to him. But all in all, we had a pretty good night. We had to come back from some bad runs our first part of the race, but for the most part, I think we did okay.
Now time for this week's trivia question. Unless you are the track promoter at Hickory, I would be really surprised if you know this one. Who won the very first race at Hickory Motor Speedway back in 1951 and then went on to become the track champion?
Discover Central Florida's East Coast, a lifestyle like no other. Miles of pristine beaches. It's the Florida you may have imagined, yet never seen. Until now, endless challenging fairways, thrilling diversions, yet laid back when you want it to be. Call Plantation Realty Services at 1-866-676-0056 or visit us online at www.plantationrealtyservices.com. We have the perfect address for your dream.
Do you dream of a career in stock car racing? Then check out CrewSchool.com, a 10-week, power-packed, hands-on training course designed to prepare students for a job in stock car racing. Learn every aspect of working on a stock car. Students start with a bare chassis and build a stock car from the ground up. Classes are small and training is hands-on, so each student gets exposed to all aspects of race car mechanics. Call toll-free 877-241-8356 or log on to CrewSchool.com.
Here's the answer to this week's trivia question. Gwen Stanley won the first ever race at Hickory back in 1951, then went on to become the first track champion at the track. Welcome back to this week's edition of ISCARS Full Throttle. Joe Moore and Tiffany Ricardo. And time now to bring in our resident technical expert, Scott Weaver.
Yep. This week, Scott's talking to us about rear ends on the ISCARS machines and kind of tells us what goes into actually changing one out.
Okay, today let's talk about the rear end of the ISCARS. What we have here is a small quick change rear end. It's called a quick change because you can change the gear ratio in it really, really quick. That's real convenient for your crew. If you're practicing, you get 30 minutes of practice and 45 minutes of practice, and you have to change the gear two or three times to get the right ratio. You're able to do it this way really, really quick. What we do, this thing's got several nuts around here. Pull all your nuts off. Your cover slides off. Grease will run out. And you get your cover off. These are the gears that we're going to be changing. Slide this set of gears out. Slide a new set of gears in. Place the cover. Bolt it all back together, put grease back in it, you're ready to get back on the racetrack. A good crew can do this in about 3 minutes. Typically when we leave the shop, we'll have a car pretty close. We know what gear we want. If we hadn't ever been to the racetrack, you usually make some phone calls, talk to some buddies, try to get some inside information, get real close on your ratio. Gear ratios determine a lot of difference in engine builders. Some engine builders like to turn more RPMs than others. When you get there, you may have to do this once, maybe twice, till you get the right ratio that you need. But generally, it don't take but once or twice.
That's all the time we have for today's edition of ISCARS Full Throttle. Don't forget, we'll be back next week with a new show. as we highlight what happened at Hickory and look ahead to the final race of the year.
Yeah, we're going to see if Eric Wilson, Joe, next week will win again at Hickory or if he's going to give somebody else a chance. He's just been on fire all year long.
Don't forget to check out our website online. We're at iscarsonline.com. You can watch past editions of the show there or go straight to theautochannel.com and watch past episodes of Full Throttle. Thanks again for watching us this week. We'll see you next week on Full Throttle.